Good, good, good. Well, I'm going to go ahead and get started, and we will touch on those campaigns just briefly. So thank you all for being here. And again, if we lose power, just be patient. We're going to do our best. Hi, Maggie. So hopefully we don't lose power. I just want to say thanks for being here and being learning based. I'm always here for you to show you a little bit more about the technology or script practice or whatever it is that you need. And we're so lucky to have Maggie on here as well. She has a special place in my heart, I'll say. She was my roommate as a salesperson years ago. Also my script partner, and she is very involved in our career development committee as well. So we just really appreciate you coming on and sharing with us, Maggie. So the agenda for today looks like this. I'm going to show you how to get to your listing presentation packet and how to customize that to make that your own. I won't go into a lot of detail there because that's a whole nother class, but just know that on Tuesdays at 10 and on Thursdays at 1, Lisa Warfield and I teach command. And we also are always open to doing one-on-ones with you. So if you ever, want a little bit more help with customizing those packets and making things your own, just let us know. So I'm going to go ahead and make Maggie, now that she's on here, I'm going to make you co-host just so I don't forget to do that in case you wanted to share anything. And I will share my screen and jump right in. So we have a YouTube channel that I encourage you to use for a couple of things. So first off, as you know, our wonderful broker, Brad Long, teaches contract classes every month. And one of them is listing contracts and one of them is sales contracts. And so if you have not gone to his listing contract class before, or even if you have, I encourage you to come to our YouTube channel and grab it here. So if you go into YouTube, it's KW Louisville East. And the very top one is listing contracts. So that's where he goes over with you the actual listing contract and how you explain that to your buyers. And that is very important to understand those paragraphs and all of those things. What Maggie and I are talking to you about today is more of the practical application of it. So you're actually going to the home and you are sitting down with that listing or with that seller for that listing presentation. I also encourage you to watch the one on finding sellers, which it's loading in now. It's the one that Drew Wisdom taught that was originally scheduled for his mom to teach, and he was able to jump in. But he had a lot of great ideas on how you can find sellers right now. So I always recommend reaching out to your sphere, asking for referrals. Farming neighborhoods, hosting open houses, that not only brings buyers, that does bring sellers as well. Especially if you're door knocking, you're in a way auditioning at that open house for maybe someone who's thinking of selling. And so it's good to, give that good performance, but also to offer to them if they'd like to sell their house, you can help them. So again, these videos here are very helpful. If you go into the Ignite sessions, you would be looking for finding sellers with Ignite Session 4 with Becky, and also with Ignite Session 5 with Seamus. He taught about the CMAs there. So you always want to have your comps with you as you go there, and he goes through the logistics of creating those comps. All right, any questions about these videos or places to find a little bit more resource? Good. All right. So let's jump on into command. And I'm going to show you how to get to where you can find your listing presentations. So we're on the home screen here, the dashboard. And if you go to designs, this is where you can find tons of templates, hundreds, probably thousands of templates. To get to your listing presentation, you should choose print. And then I have to move our faces out of there. Okay, and then down here at the bottom, you'll hit the blue plus sign. This box will pop up, so you wanna make sure it says print. And hit next. And after that, you will have templates load. that you can use. And if you choose listings over to the left and then listing presentations, this is how you can choose from two different templates that we have. It's a very user-friendly system. If you hover over it and you choose use, then all of the pages that are available to you will pop up on the left-hand side. So this is kind of like the collection of all of the pages that you might use for your listing presentation packet. And as you see, there's some main graphics. There's where you can customize with your seller's names. You can look at some specifics in the neighborhood, the picture of their home, as well as the stats of their neighborhood. And then you could use this for your comps. And if you go through, you'll see there's more info on the process, on your app and how that can help with the sale of the home, your marketing plan, how you can find a buyer and what the stats are on that, as well as media, marketing, open house. So as you see, there's a lot over here. Now, logistically, all you have to do to create this to be your own is just click the page. And there's a plus sign up there as well. But really, if you just click on the page, it will bring that page over to your workspace. So think about this side as all of the options available. Think about this as your workspace. Okay. So you just go through and you add as many pages as you like. And just keep hitting them. And then they will continue to gather over into your workspace. You'll want some comps. Now, in order to see the pages that you have added to your workspace so far, if you see at the bottom, it says pages with a little arrow. If you click on that, you're going to be able to view at a quick glance all the ones that you have created so far. Okay. At this point, you still have the option to do some editing here. So you have, you know, you could trash that page if you change your mind. You can copy that page if you'd like to make it more than one. You can add more here with the plus sign, okay? So you can really add as much as you want here. What I would also do is encourage you to come up to this red box at the top right and name it. So I advise that you have one packet ready that you could just grab on the fly. So go ahead and have something maybe that's not customized, and you could call that a model packet. And of course, it wouldn't have the specific neighborhood or the name of your seller. But if you just were in a hurry and needed to run out the door and print something quickly, you could have that model packet. So once you name that there, you're going to come over to File and Save. And now this will be saved in your designs. Once you have all the pages chosen that you'd like, what you can do is click on those pages at any point from down here or from right here, and you can double click inside of it and change the text, okay? You can also change the graphics, and you can change the logos, okay? And what you would do is you could click on that box and you could hit delete. And if you come over to logos on the left-hand side, that is where you can add in the one that you have for our brokerage or the one that you have for your team. Okay, any questions so far? All right, perfect. Now I will show you one thing that if you are in your design templates, one thing that I would do before you get started on this part of customizing it is check your library. So over to the right-hand side, you see the library sign. This is where you want to check your details. Make sure you've got your name, the brokerage, the email that you'd like to use, phone number, address in there. You can also click text. So you can get to, if you have a bio or any slogans that you use or mottos that you like, you can put those there. Any images you feel like you might be using throughout your marketing, you can upload right here. And so what this is doing is it's putting it into a library for you so that as you're in each individual marketing piece, you can quickly grab these images or logos as you wish. As far as logos here, you can add in all the ones. And just an FYI, if you see the checkered ones, that doesn't mean those checkers show up. It just means it blends into the background, that it's transparent. I also wanted to remind you that on the email that I send to you all weekly, that's usually subject line named the week of at KWLE, this has a marketing drive for you toward the bottom, that when you click on that, you have access not just to graphics that I create and designs for you and put your our logo on, it also has the logos. So if you are in that drive, you can actually scroll to the bottom and you'll see these logos here. When you see the one that says command, just know that that one is in the size 360 by 360. And that's the one that makes the most sense with command, so that that way you, your photo won't look smushed in any way. All right. So, and then brand kit would be if you had specific colors for your logo, your marketing, things that you'd like to use, it can actually allow you to add in those colors here by the code number. So you want to make sure that library is built there for you so that that way you can easily grab it. The other thing I'd like to show you is that on my designs, if any of you have ever had maybe another program that you use to create something and you would like to bring that into command, you can actually do that by importing files, importing them right here. So when you're in My Designs, you would come here and click Import, and let's just maybe grab Value Proposition. Now, there's a couple of things to keep in mind that when you bring in an import, it might not always translate as far as font. So this is what will happen. So as you see, it popped over here, and it's going to ask you some questions about fonts. So I would go ahead and hit replace all and then choose from the library. Now, depending on what you're building, you might want something that's got bold or light graphics. I've found that the Roboto Slab Regular is a pretty decent one. So usually that's the one that I put on everything. And once you hit that and hit continue, and then it's gonna ask you things about pixels. It does say that the pixels are best suited for the web, while inches are best suited for print. And so remember, if we're printing this out and it's a listing packet, then we probably want to choose inch. And once you do that, it's going to start converting and it's going to start bringing that into command for you. So, you know, again, if you already have a listing packet, or maybe you find something that another program has that you'd like to use rather than the templates that I showed you, this is a way that you can bring that in. Any questions about that? You can do the same thing with graphics as well. Now, one thing too is that when you import, you want to kind of go through and see what it's done. You know, you might have to move things around a little bit. You know, sometimes it might just overlap, or it might need you to expand out. You know, it's not 100% perfect, but as you see, it brought in most of it. So it really did most of the work there for you, and it kept that specific layout. So again, you know, when you have a listing presentation, you can go in through those templates and use that to customize, or you can bring in something else. All right. Let's see. One other thing that while we're in designs that I wanted to show you is more about the lead generation of it. So to get back to the homepage, you just click off the X at the top. And so in the designs themselves, I'd like to show you where you can find some great ways to generate leads that are seller leads. So if you are choosing social, and I have to keep moving our faces. There we go. So keep choosing social and the plus sign. And Kim, I know you're good about this. You're pretty good at the marketing piece so far. You could probably teach this part. So here are some other places where you can find some great graphics to generate those leads. The app, of course, you always want to have the app on your social media. Encourage everybody to download that. Make sure that you're grabbing your specific app code from the consumer applet in command. And if you need help with that, you can let me know. You can also go to where it says listings and choose local expert. So one way to really grab the seller's attention is by showing them numbers, showing them specifics. So anything about the market. So you can go on to the hot sheet on the MLS daily and pull those stats and just remind people that yes, it's a hot market. Things are still selling. Now's a great time to sell. You can also see some more graphics here on the comparison of renting, buying, and you know that's more for buyers, but you could see some of those that are about what is your home worth. So if you click on lead generation and you see home value, these are some graphics that would do just that. So you can see, do you know the value of your home? What is your home worth? And again, these graphics are in my marketing drive already put with our logo on there for you to use. So I encourage you just go on to social media and really entice people to sit down with you, even if it's via Zoom, and to go over a CMA on their house. Another thing that you'll probably want to do is get them set up on a smart plan as well. So if you have a smart plan already set up for this, that's great. If you don't have any smart plans yet, then all you need to do is go over to the library. And these are all the ones that Keller Williams offers to you. And Howie, I know you're good at this. You've already started putting people on your smart plan. So this is great. One thing that I would recommend that everybody in your database get on is this monthly neighborhood nurture. So what this does is based on them as a contact and the address that you have in the system for them, it will send them the statistics of their neighborhood. So you're staying top of mind for them. One, you're not a secret agent. And the other thing is they're keeping an eye on the value of their house. And as they see their values rise, that might get them thinking that they might want to sell. So this is a great way to encourage them, either by knowing the value of their home specifically by doing a CMA with you, or just by getting that monthly email with you so they can keep up on the stats of their neighborhood. And then the last thing that I'll show you is the campaign. So this is another great way to begin to start generating some leads. So if you're in the campaign applet, you go to paid ads and you go to create a new campaign and you're going to choose social ad. If you've never done this before, then make sure that you go up to the top right where your picture is and go into your settings and connect your Facebook accounts. And again, there's classes on this. I'm happy to do this one-on-one with you. What you'll do is maybe name it Finding Sellers. This is just for you. You could attract listings. You could advertise a listing. So if you're looking for sellers specifically, these are two that you would want to use. Now in our brokerage, Brad Long is the owner of every client. So keep this in mind that he has given his permission that you can advertise any listing in our office. You'd also want to maybe give the listing agent a courtesy call and just make sure that they're okay with it. 99.9% of the time that listing agent is going to say, yes, advertise my listing. So just keep that in mind that if you don't have listings on your own to advertise, you can go ahead and use someone else's. So once you hit advertise listing, you're going to come down and choose Facebook. And I wouldn't worry so much about Twitter. It hasn't had as many results. And don't worry about Instagram either. Facebook owns Instagram, so it's already doing that work for you. And then you will hit set up campaign. And at that point, it's going to pull in a drawer, is what this is called, where you can search for the listing that you would like to advertise. It always defaults to only my listings. So over here, choose all listings. And this is where you can go in and choose it by the listing agent, by the property address, the MLS number. Once you find the one that you want to advertise, you hit select and it brings in the information over here. So the preview box is there for you so you can see how it looks as you go along. When you pull in that listing, it's also going to pop in the description here. You can make a short, catchy headline, a little description. So lots of things that you can put here. You'll also add some media to it. So you'll put your logo in, you're going to add pictures from that listing. And then when you're on the Facebook ad part, this is one very important piece. So you're finding sellers and you want to get them into your database. You've always got to make sure that you check this use Facebook lead gen form. Okay, it's given me some errors because I'm not completing it. But again, I don't want to go into too much detail. But I did want you to know that when you click this part and it says lead gen form, then as people click on the learn more option of your campaign ad, then automatically their name, email address, and sometimes their phone number will go and pop into your contacts. And if you are using Kelly, you will get notifications on that as soon as you get a lead. And then if you just go into the main page, which I don't have any active campaigns, I'm no longer an active agent, but right here is where you would see all the campaigns that are running. And at that point, you can actually get into your leads as well and see how many you have.
If you want to see what that looks like, if you want to see what it looks like, I put a screenshot of what mine looks like in the chat box.
Oh, okay. Here, let's, okay, perfect. Awesome. And so those are ways that you can find sellers and that you can attract them. You can get their info captured. But of course, like any other lead gen, when it comes to sellers, you want to call them right away and you want to get them set up on a smart plan. You want to make an appointment. You still have to work on that conversion and those scripts. So any questions about the listing packet or any of the designs or campaigns?
Where's the most effective scripts that you found about Facebook leads coming in? What script would you recommend?
I would treat it as though it were any internet script. One thing that I can show you is when you, I know that you were in Ignite and mm-hmm. that you had the drive for Ignite, and I'm also happy to share that with anyone else. So when you're in the Ignite drive, can you all see my screen? Okay, just making sure. All right. So when you are in the scripts or in the Ignite part, there is a special tab here for scripts and it will say Ignite Spark and Ignite Elementals. The Spark is kind of the beginning scripts and then the Elementals is really diving in. So I would take a look at this. I would keep this, I would download it and keep it on your computer and have that handy. Because there's so many things like, yes, I've already seen this house online. I just need to know if I like it. You know, it's really addressing a lot of different scenarios there for you. But I would treat any Facebook lead just like you would if you were purchasing internet leads and you're converting. My best advice is to ask them, what is it about that house that you liked? You know, rather than going through the robotic, you know, what are you looking for? If it's a buyer or a seller, even, you know, you kind of want to ask questions. You know, why are you moving? What's your motivation? And Maggie will probably talk a little bit about that too. You really want to establish with these sellers, what is their motivation? Because if, when things get choppy, difficult along the way, if there's objections or if they have any difficulty with their buyers, you know, it's always good to return them to that motivation and just encourage them that we are going to get through this because this is your dream. You know, remember you're trying to get to Florida and, or Italy, whatever. And you just return them to that motivation. All right. Great question. Anything else? Yes.
You know how you said you pull the pictures over to your campaign for the listing? Like if you take someone else's listing or even if it's your own listing, you're pulling the pictures. Where are you pulling those pictures from if it's not your listing?
When that drawer popped out where it said to select the listing, it once you select one, all of that info comes
okay,
in.
Okay, it just pulls over automatically. Mm-hmm. Okay, yep. I thought you were saying we had to like upload them or something.
Nope. It makes it so simple in command because when you have a listing that's in the MLS, then our KWLS immediately will grab that info. And so that's what you're pulling from in command is the KWLS. And it pulls in all those pictures and all those descriptions.
That's perfect.
Good question. On the description part, the whole description will come over, and it could be 250 characters, I believe. But good practice for marketing is to never go over 125 characters. You really want to leave them intrigued. And the same for the pictures, too. So what I recommend is grab a photo that's kind of catchy. It catches their eye. Don't give them just another, you know, normal shot of a living room. Give them something that's mysterious that kind of makes them, oh, wow, like I want to see the rest of that house. And when you are doing that campaign, also on the destination URL, put your website rather than a landing page for that listing, because then that way, if they go into that and they don't like that listing, they can still search for more while they're at your webpage. But if you lead them to a landing page, then that's all they see is that one listing. So, you know, again, those are a little bit more detailed instructions. And if you'd like to do a one-on-one with me, you can, and I can step you through that. But campaigns is a great way to go right now. I mean, really, with everything that we have with Command, you can get these leads. Like Howie said, it's less than a dollar a lead. Whereas if you're on realtor.com or Zillow, the forbidden Zillow, you can be spending hundreds or thousands a month, and there's really no point in doing that. And the other great thing about it is that as those leads come in, they're automatically going into your database. And it's real easy for you to just pop them onto a monthly neighborhood nurture smart plan, or do whatever else with them. Once they're in your contacts, you have lots of other things you can do, creating the opportunities or the marketing.
So I actually have a couple other questions. Mm-hmm. When you said don't go over 125 characters, do you mean when we're actually inputting our own listings too? Like in the description, we shouldn't go over 125 characters?
No? Not necessarily. Okay. You know, if you ever have so much of a description that you have that someone has to click show more to get to it, I feel like that might be being a little bit too wordy.
I get a little wordy sometimes.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. You know, just say things, even if it's short and clipped, that grabs their attention, that makes them want more. The point is you want them to not have all of the info so that they have to reach out to you to get it.
Right.
Now, at the same time, for our fellow agents and the agent notes, if there's something special, you do want to put that info there. But I would give as much information, but keep it, you know, keep it short and sweet. So that, especially for the campaign purpose, because that's more of a marketing purpose. Now on the MLS, that description is going to be more geared towards, you know, describing all the great details of this listing, what your sellers would want to see.
But yeah, I think there's a fine line between sharing just the right amount of information and not enough. I mean, some of them are embarrassing when you see like one sentence. Mm-hmm. But others, I feel like, I mean, it's like they've written a book and nobody, you get tired of reading it. So,
yep.
I mean, I feel like you need to put the important stuff in there. But I mean, after all these years, I'm still, it still probably takes me the longest for my listings is to write that description.
Yeah.
Kind of segues me into my other question is that when it comes to like no-nos in your description, you know how people are looking, well, I mean, unfortunately, like you get called on some of these things. Like I try to obviously stay away from the, you know, just a walk away from, you know, whatever, things like that. But I didn't know if there was some way we could figure out the other no-nos that we shouldn't be talking about, ages of, you know, like, you know, the mechanicals and stuff I just learned I shouldn't be putting in there, stuff like that. I wouldn't know if somebody didn't tell me.
I use the word updated a lot because as long as it's not original, I mean, it's been updated at some point.
Mm-hmm.
And then that way, because it's shocking to me how many people are wrong, how many sellers are wrong on the ages. You know, a home inspector can come out and pull a serial number on an HVAC and see exactly when it was manufactured. And I've seen people be horribly wrong. And I don't think they were necessarily, you know, malicious about it, but buyers get upset when they think, you know, an HVAC is 4 years old and it turns out to be 14.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And for the rest of the wording, I would just ask yourself, like, is this, am I commenting on something that is describing a protected class or a protected, you know, if it's, if you say view, I mean, technically you have to think about those who are blind. I've heard that the words pride of ownership also are not good, you know? So you really, you got to just ask yourself, is this referring to somebody who could be, have some type of an inability to enjoy what it is I'm describing?
Family friendly is still something. I mean, I see top agents still using family friendly, and that is a huge no-no.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, talking about locations to specific churches, you know, that's another thing that comes up a lot that you're not supposed to do.
Yeah, absolutely.
Safe. I mean, yeah, safe neighborhood. Everyone has a different version of what safe is.
That's right. That's right. And, you know, and people, and this is something I always go over in orientation and we talk about with contracts, but if somebody's asking you, is that a good neighborhood, you know, just make sure that you ask them what's important to that, to you about that. And if they're really talking about just the values and investing, as long as you can show the comps on that there's been, you know, some increases over the last couple of years, then that's fine to talk about. Anything else, just advise them to call the local police department. And you can even say it's because the police are able to answer that question for you, or go to crimemapping.com.
Yeah, I had some, a young couple, they were obsessed with crime, but I didn't know them well enough to know what mattered to them. So every listing we went to, they would pull up crime mapping when we pulled in. And that was their way of deciding whether or not they were comfortable with it. And it was worked well for me, because then I didn't have to be the one who determined whether or not it was what they considered a safe neighborhood.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, thanks for those questions. And again, if any of you ever need a little bit of help with doing anything that I went over briefly with you, the listing presentation, the campaigns, the smart plans, or even help with writing descriptions, just let me know. So Maggie, thank you again for being here and talking to us about what happens next. So you're going to the listing appointment, and what's it like? What do you, tell us about your experiences.
Right. So for those who don't know me, I started in 2004, spent 11 years at Seminin, and then moved to Keller Williams in 2015. And that was the best decision I ever made. And I was telling Aimee when we were talking about this class, I have a memory from about 14 years ago that still is vividly in my mind. And I think of this whenever I go on a listing appointment. I'd only been in the business about a year and a half, probably only sold two or three houses at that point. And I had a client that I had sold a house to. It was an internet lead. They had just had a baby. And so they wanted me to come over and meet the baby. And they just asked if I could give them an idea of the value of their house. They had done some updates since they bought it. So I went over there, just brought a little bit of information on comps. And as soon as I walked in, the husband started grilling me as a listing presentation. And at that point, I had not done it enough to just be able to wing it. I was incredibly uncomfortable. I was also dealing with morning sickness at the time. So it was really bad combination. And it was really awkward. I never heard from them again. They ended up listing with another agent. The interesting part was, is it took their house about 2 years to sell, and they went through multiple realtors. So that was the one thing that was made me feel a little bit better about it. But ever since, I have made sure to over prepare. It's much better to have a bunch of information you don't end up needing to go over than feeling overwhelmed because you get there and you realize that you don't have what they are expecting. So I always make sure to, I always carry extra listing presentations with me, so I've got them. And just making sure that I spend plenty of time, you know, comparables, you know, going over the comps is a big thing. I try to, and I send Aimee a pre-listing form. I try to call, you know, depending on how you got the seller referral, if it's a text or an email or call, try to get them on the phone and get as much information ahead of time so you know how to prepare. And also, if you all have any questions during this, please feel free to stop me and ask, because I can ramble sometimes. But the pre-listing form has questions on it. Motivation, like Aimee mentioned, is amazingly important. You have sellers right now who just want to kind of see how much they can get for their house. That is very different than somebody who has accepted a job out of state, has to be there in 2 weeks and needs to sell before they can buy. So that's huge, making sure you know what their motivation is. And I always try to find out how much they think their house is worth. Some people purposely won't share that information with you. They want you to bring that number. But you have people who obsess over Zestimates, and you never know where that value is going to be. Or they've done a bunch of research online. So try to find out where they are with the value, because then you can really tailor your listing appointment and your comps to that number. What you're hoping is that their estimate is below what it's worth, but if it's way above what it's worth, you can kind of come in and be really prepared to back up whatever number you have. And I don't ask every single one of these questions. You know, some of these conversations are longer than others. But besides motivation and price, it's good to find out where they heard about you. Obviously, if it's a referral, they're going to just feel a lot more confident in how you can represent them. If it's an internet lead, you want to know where that came from. And then finding out what updates they've done to their house. That is another huge thing. I was telling Aimee, my parents had a beautiful house in Florida. I helped interview two top realtors in their market. I told both of them that they had completely renovated their house. They both spoke to my parents ahead of time, and they both showed up to the listing appointment. I think they pulled pictures from when they had bought it before they had gutted it. And both of them showed up with comps on massive fixer-uppers. So neither agent had numbers they could use in their listing appointment. They both had to go back home and resend that information. And I was shocked. I mean, these agents, their average sales price is easily $1.5 million. And they both came to those appointments just really unprepared when it came to price. So what I do, try to get information on the updates they've done, but know that updates can vary. Some people do very high-end kitchen renovations. Some people do very poor kitchen renovations. So I try to bring comps all across the board, from houses that need updating to ones that have been completely renovated. And then as I'm walking through the house, you're seeing how well it was done, and you can sift through those when you sit down with the sellers and only go over the ones that apply to the house. That was another, I think another interesting one, to really follow. You know, pulling up if there's any previous MLS information, if it's sold before, that's obviously quite helpful. You want to go over the tax records. But you have to remember that the PVA can be incorrect. I do a lot in Oldham County, and sometimes it's not even the right floor plan. I've showed up to 4-bedroom houses where the PVA said it was 2 bedrooms. So make sure that you get that information from the seller. Find out if it's in a floodplain, because obviously that makes a huge difference. Something I don't do as frequently, and I should, because I know agents have gotten burned on this, is you can get on the county clerk's office and see if there's any Liz pendants against the property. You know, if they're in foreclosure, that's obviously a huge deal. And then making sure that the tax records names match the people that you're meeting. You want to make sure that you're meeting with the right people when you go to the house. You guys have any questions about that pre-listing form?
Maggie, I'm emailing that to everybody that saw it too. Okay. And the seller counseling form that you sent as well.
Yeah. So I have a separate seller counseling form. Some of the information is repetitive, because you don't always get that during the pre-listing call. And then if anything, if I, everything I'm able to fill out ahead of time is obviously helpful. And like I said, with the pre-listing form, I don't go over every single one of these questions. But if during the listing, if things are a little uncomfortable, you're having trouble kind of relating to the sellers, it's just helpful to have these reminders of what you need to talk about. You know, obviously things are odd right now with COVID. You know, we've talked a little bit about doing Zoom appointments. You know, Zoom listing appointments can be tough. Because there's just certain things you don't see when you are not actually inside the property. Animal smells, smoke smells, you know, how dirty it is in person. I've done one Zoom listing call, and it was tough with the internet issues. Everything was blurry. So I try to get there in person if at all possible. And what I do when I walk up to the house is I leave my mask off so people can see what I look like before it goes on. You know, it's always awkward when you meet people for the first time with half your face covered. So I try to do that and then put the mask on kind of once I wave to them so they get a little bit of an idea of what I look like ahead of time. I always ask if they want me to take my shoes off when I get in there, kind of depending on cultural things or just how, you know, how they feel about cleanliness. That's something I like to do as well. And then Aimee, obviously stop me too if you wanted to do any sort of role playing during this. Once I get in there, I set my stuff down. And then if you all have been in Bold, I know with the Bold teachings, they recommend that you walk through the house while you have the seller fill out some information. I've done that before. I personally like the seller to come with me so they can point out particular updates that they've done in each part of the house. That way I don't have to go back and ask about that specifically. You know, you obviously need to do it whichever way you feel most comfortable. There's a great Bold script about that, saying that, you know, you want to look, walk through the house and see it through the buyer's eyes. But I've just found I can be more efficient if I bring the seller with me. Another thing that's kind of interesting, I always leave my wallet in my car for listing appointments. I don't like to carry my big purse around with me while I'm touring, and I also don't want my stuff sitting there. So I make sure to leave that information in my car just to be on the safe side. And then once we've walked through the house, then I sit down with the seller, and depending on how the house looks, we kind of start talking about things like neutralizing, decluttering. You know, as you all have seen, houses can vary drastically between ones that you can list tomorrow and ones that may need a month or two of updates. You know, obviously we all hope that we're going to get those that have been completely gutted and you can get those professional photos tomorrow, but I would say at least, you know, half my listings, I'll meet with the sellers multiple times, after they've gotten different stages of work done before we're able to sell. Now, you all in this group, how long have you all been in the business, and have you, you know, sold many listings at this point?
I've only sold my own houses. So I have not, as a licensed agent, I haven't done one just yet.
Okay. So do you flip, Howie?
Yeah, we've done a couple and then a rental house.
Okay. Okay, great. Kim, what about you?
I'm Becky's admin.
Oh, so okay. I knew your name sounded familiar.
I'm not licensed, but I'm just curious from an admin's perspective what you guys do actually on the appointment. So this is helpful.
Well, I know Becky is great at this kind of stuff as well. So, and then is it Courtney? Are you our last?
Yeah, I've been an agent for a year and 3 months now.
Okay.
Yeah, a year and 3 months. So I've sold a lot of listings for that time period. I mean, It seems like a lot, but not a ton, but enough to get some experience. And I sold my boyfriend's house, so that was an experience. And yeah. I was going to ask you a question, actually. Sure. About the, you said you check the tax records to make sure that the names match the sellers that you're going to meet with at the listing appointment. Mm-hmm. Is that for safety purpose? Or, like, what is the situation with that?
So I thankfully have not run into an issue where somebody has tried to sell a property that they didn't have legal ownership to, but I know that's happened within our office. And then obviously for safety reasons, I mean, thankfully the majority of my business is referral and past clients, but I do work with some internet leads. So you want to make sure, you know, that that does match. And I also Google people. If I have not, you know, if they're an internet lead, I've never met them before, I try to do as much research ahead of time just to make sure that, you know, you're not walking into a situation that can be dangerous.
Have you ever looked up somebody on the county clerk before you went to the appointment and they were actually in pre-foreclosure and you had to, and they weren't going to have that conversation with you on the front end?
I have talked to a couple of leads on the phone that were in pre-foreclosure, and they were in stages where we couldn't get them out of the hole at that point. I had a situation where I was representing the buyer. And it was one of those where they didn't even find it. The seller was served during the contract period. So it wasn't even something that would have shown up if I looked it up before we wrote an offer on the property. And thankfully we ended up closing because they had a huge amount of equity in the house, but it delayed the closing because, that Liz Pendens was filed. I guess the seller just, I don't know how long she hadn't been paying her mortgage, but thankfully that's only happened to me once. But I mean, you know, you'd like to think that people are honest. I know Becky in the sales meeting last week was talking about forbearance. You know, with COVID, if sellers have filed for forbearance, then they need to make sure, you know, that's a question you ask and, you know, find out if it's going to be an issue, because a lot of sellers are planning on buying. I always make sure that my sellers get pre-approved if they're going to buy before I list their property, because if they find out that they can't buy another house midway through the process, I mean, things can get really ugly. So that's something I always require my sellers to do.
Ugly.
All right. So when I sit down with the sellers, kind of depending on what I've seen, we discuss things. You know, anybody who's from Louisville or has been here a certain amount of time knows what a small town it is. I mean, there's people that have connections between work and church and family. You'll see a wall of 30 family photos between, you know, every member of the family tree. And so I work really hard to try to get the sellers to pack up all of that stuff ahead of time. So when buyers walk in, they're not immediately trying to figure out who the sellers are. You know, it's so important for sellers to apply to a really broad group of buyers. And if you walk in and this, you know, the house screams 70-year-old grandma, then a 25-year-old single guy is going to have trouble looking past that. And vice versa, you got a single guy and it looks like a bachelor pad, then a family of four may not be able to look past it. So and you've got to be careful not to insult people. I had somebody years ago who didn't use me because I recommended that she painted over the bedroom that she had covered all of the walls with her grandkids' handprints of all different colors. I mean, it was incredibly tacky. And obviously, once she sold the house, it didn't matter, but she was really insulted by the fact that I thought that was a necessary thing for her to do. And I've actually lost at least a couple of listings that way when I've had sellers that have had really odd, distinct design styles and massive amounts of clutter. And that is one thing that I can be a deal breaker for me, because I know how much that can affect selling a listing and getting a top price for a seller. And, you know, I'm okay in those couple circumstances, because when I, sometimes I will watch listings that I didn't get to see how they go with the agent that they chose. And I, you know, a lot of times I'll see that that listing takes months and months to sell when it shouldn't have. So you've got to, during the entire process, that is a question to ask. And I know it's tough in the beginning. I mean, I used to put, granted, nobody puts anybody in their car anymore, but I used to put anybody in my car that breathed the word house. And I mean, I would take any listing I could get. And you've just got to be careful because there are certain people that will suck the life out of you. You know, those really bad clients, you know, they can take the entire day away from you and keep you from working with the ones that are really good. So just make sure when you're done with that listing appointment that it is something that you truly want, because, you know, not every listing is a good one. And I know with it being a seller's market, it makes things a little bit easier, but not everything is flying off the market. There are still houses that are sitting, and we're the ones that look bad when they don't sell. And so I have got a listing presentation that I use, and I wanted to make sure I got on here early with Aimee to see the one in command. I like the one that I use, but it's really large and I have trouble emailing it to people. Granted, I always bring a paper copy with me and leave it with the sellers. But in some cases you do want to be able to email it. So I think we're going to play around with the one on command. I'll show you the one that I use. I'm going to pull it up here and see if it.
Maggie, I can try sharing it through the chat as well and see if we're able to download it. I'm not sure if it would be too big, but I can try.
Okay.
Thanks, Eli.
Yeah, I asked to be on here for me. Let's see if this. Okay. Can you all see that?
And just a thought. So I have a lot of things that I share with the rest of leadership team. And if they're too big, what I do is I create a Google Drive and then I create a link that's shareable. And you have to go into the settings of the drive itself and make sure that anyone with the link can grab it. But that could be another way to get around things being too big.
And that's exactly how we end up doing it, is sharing it through a Google link, which I just have some clients are, you know, are a little bit less tech savvy. So I'd love to be able to have a PDF version as well. So when I bring my listing presentation, like I said, I like to be over prepared, but you'll meet with some people where you only go over, you know, a tenth of what you brought. You know, some people want to see all of the numbers, all of your information, and others just kind of, you know, want their questions answered. So, you know, be prepared to go over it all, but kind of play off their cues. You know, I went to one the other day where it was a referral. I had sold the exact floor plan across the street and the two owners had been best friends. So I went through maybe 2 minutes of my listing presentation and that's all they wanted to hear. Because I'd already been referred and they really wanted to more discuss numbers and what to do to get the house ready. You know, I have my bio just in case this is an internet lead and they don't know much about me.
Maggie, I don't think we can see what you're showing us. Can anyone else see it?
Oh, it's paused. Let me see. Oh, I wonder if it's, let's see. It might be because it's too big. Eli, do you want to try doing it?
And I can make him a co-host so that he can hear.
Yeah, I think it's too big.
There we go, Eli, you should be able to now. And actually, Maggie, you'll have to stop share in order for him to be able to share. And
so actually, I just shared it through chat. So you should be able to, everyone should be able to access it, actually. If you were wanting to do it that way. I just pulled it. Yeah. So you actually, everyone has access to it through chat. If you wanted to go about it that way.
Okay. All right. And I'm just going to go over a couple things on here. All right. Well, I'm just, you guys can look at that later if you want. you know, there's my bio that I'll discuss a little bit about. I like going over my stats and comparing it to GLAR's stats because my days on market and my price from list to sale is higher than the Greater Louisville Association of Realtors average. So the people who like numbers like to hear that. And then I have a big section in there on staging and then what I do marketing wise. You know, it's interesting because, you know, everything is internet marketing based right now. You know, Aimee and I talked a little bit about whether or not things like postcards made sense anymore. I mean, when I first got into the business, we had a monthly book that went into the Kroger's that had your listings in it. You know, and it just, things are so fast paced that, you know, and some people do really care about how you tell them you're going to market the property. You know, and thankfully Keller Williams has amazing, you know, amazing internet presence, you know, doing targeted Facebook marketing are things that we do. But staging the property well, pricing it right, and getting the right pictures in this market are going to have the biggest impact because when things are selling in 12 hours, you want everything just right in the beginning. I did a lot of walkthrough videos when COVID first hit, but what I'm seeing right now, and I don't know if any of you all are seeing that too, is, you know, I wonder how many people are actually seeing the walkthrough videos because, you know, you're barely getting them online before you have 15 showings and 5 offers. So I'm going to continue doing that for my higher end properties. Yeah, I'm getting ready to list a $150,000 house in Linden, and there's no point in doing a walkthrough video on that one. You know, we'll have 50 showings on it in 2 days. So this is through Michael Lewis Marketing. Eli is my amazing admin, and he created this for me. You know, I love the color scheme of it. You know, obviously some of these photos are a little more California-esque, but it looks high-end, and I've had people comment, you know, if they like the look of it. But this is just a really good thing to have during the listing presentation for you to kind of flip through and really spend more time on the pages that are more important to the people that you're meeting with. Aimee, did you want to do any sort of role-playing with regards to, you know, the decluttering or depersonalizing or anything like that? Or did you want to wait until we get to pricing?
You know, I think that one of the objections that people, that you're going to notice when you come to these listings is that people have been living in this home and they're comfortable. And to them, they probably cleaned before you got there and they probably decluttered a little bit. But from the buyer's perspective and from our perspective as agents, our expectations are a little higher. So I guess, how would you answer this? That, well, Maggie, I'd love to get rid of all that stuff, but I don't really have anywhere to put it.
Right. Well, and one of the amazing things that, are really common in our market are pods. You know, pods and U-Haul, you're going to be packing up and moving anyway. You might as well start with that process. You can pack up all of the things that are really valuable to you, things that a child can easily, you know, knock over and break. Another thing what I like to do is when I'm showing comps, I like to print off the most important pictures of each listing. And so I make sure to point out a house that's had professional photos that's obviously been staged and a house that hasn't been. Because one thing that our professional photos do is they really pick up on the tiny things in each room. If you've got a bookshelf with 1,000 books, that is the main thing you see in that photo. So I really like, and that can be quite effective, is showing people, you know, look at the difference between how this house looks in photos and how this other one looks. Because people tend to understand that part of it. And I tell them, you know, that nobody lives in a staged home. I mean, that's just not how we live. But what you want to do is show off the features of the house and they can get distracted by all of those little things within a property. In 16 years, I've had one situation where a buyer's kids ripped up a toy of a child at a listing of mine, and it turned out that the agent sat in the kitchen and let the family just walk through the house, which was kind of shocking to me. But I use that story. I mean, I tell people all the time that, you know, people can get away from us and walk into other rooms, and you don't want things that, you know, somebody can get a hold of. So thankfully, you know, there was a situation about 4 months ago where the seller, they had a lot of really gaudy decor, and they, I think, were insulted by the fact that I wanted them to put it up. And, you know, they ended up listing with somebody else. I could tell in the photos that not a single item was removed, and it took 3 months to sell at a lower price than I thought it was worth. So, you know, it, you've got to do it in a kind way and talk in generalizations so people don't think you're specifically attacking their house, because some people do get very, you know, and I've had people who have, you know, very strong religious artwork, and that's something that they feel very strongly about. So you want to kind of decide ahead of time if that's something that you want to discuss or if you want to let them leave it, because I've had people feel very strongly about things like that. And as long as it's not insulting, I showed a house once where there were nude photos of the wife in the hallway and in the master bathroom. And it was actually a realtor's listing. That is something I would recommend never leaving in a house. You know, some things are, you know, aren't worth, you know, battling over, as long as it's not something that is going to, you know, insult somebody. You know, obviously there's things going on right now that you just want to make sure that there's nothing in the property that could, you know, could turn somebody off in that way and keep them from writing an offer, because the largest buyer pool you have in the house, the more offers you're going to get, and the better price you're going to walk away with. So most people understand that. I also really like to talk to my sellers about being as honest and as detailed on the seller's disclosure. I'm sure you guys have all seen seller's disclosures where people have lived there 10 years and according to them, not a single thing has happened to the house. And that's, I mean, that's not real life. And buyers, if they find out something during the home inspection that the inspector tells them there's no way the seller didn't know, they become incredibly paranoid. Mm-hmm. So I tell them, if you have any question, put it in there. People will overlook almost anything in a seller's disclosure, but if it comes up on a home inspection or a week after closing, that's when things get really ugly. So that is something I will mention time and time again, is just make sure to just put everything on that seller's disclosure. And then you want to talk to them about how worried they are about COVID. You know, everybody is in a different situation right now. I have some clients who are completely fine with people being in their house with no PPE. I have others that want the booties, the gloves, the masks. They want the waiver signed. So you just need to make sure that you go with whatever option they feel most comfortable with, and then make sure they know that they need to wipe their house down after their showings. And that's another reason why sellers really need to do all of the legwork ahead of time, because nobody wants their house on the market for 2 months right now with 45 showings. You know, the quicker they can get it sold and move forward, whether they're moving out of state or moving to a dream home, it just makes sense to do it now.
Maggie, have you had any of your sellers say that they didn't want people coming through, that they just wanted to show virtually through videos?
I have not. I mean, and I've had some really elderly sellers. I've had sellers with some medical conditions, and for whatever reason, one thing I like to do, and we kind of got away from it last year when the market softened slightly, I like to list my properties on like a Thursday with no showings till Saturday morning, allow people to look at it for 2 full days. You know, we'll review offers Sunday night or Monday afternoon. And that way the sellers can be out of the house for 2 days. They only have to clean the house for 2 days. And hopefully then it's under contract. I mean, I feel like that is one of the ways to get as many people into the house without you having to worry about cleaning for weeks and weeks on end. Are any of you guys doing that right now? And it's, you know, you're going to get those buyers that are the buyer's agents that are annoyed because they want to be the first ones in. They want to be the first ones to write the offer and give you 2 hours response time. But then you get the people that are really upset that they couldn't get in. So you have a larger group that's going to be happy that you're giving people time to get into a listing. So whenever possible, I try to do it that way. And, you know, 90% of the time you're in this market, especially if you've priced it right and staged it well, it's going to be gone in that 2-day period.
So I have a question about the staging. So you mentioned that you encourage the sellers by showing them pictures of a non-staged house and a staged home. How do you usually handle it? And does it depend on maybe the price range? Do you set up that consultation? Do you cover it? How do you go about it?
So I, for the most part, have gotten pretty lucky. I've had a couple properties where they were higher end homes with a very distinct, in both cases, country style. And I knew that the majority of the people looking at these homes were going to be young families. And it was something that the sellers felt very strongly about. You know, they had their handmade quilts hanging on the walls. So in those cases, I did bring stagers in and I paid for the initial consultation. And then they give you advice on what to do. I had a house in Norton Commons that had a very old-fashioned style to it, and that's mostly young families. So in that case, we also, I paid for the first stager, and then the seller paid for the stager to do the additional work. Thankfully, you don't have to necessarily bring a stager in. I mean, just decluttering can have a huge impact on a property. And with it being a seller's market, you just truthfully don't need it as much. You know, eventually we'll shift back into more of a buyer's market and that kind of thing is going to become more important. You know, I think most agents do pay for that initial consultation, which is anywhere from, I think, $75 to $150, depending on who you bring out.
Okay.
But the nice thing is that the, you know, putting it on the stager takes away from you being the one who, you know, gives them the bad news about their decor being hideous.
Can you put in the chat box who you would recommend for that?
Yeah, I will. Eli, do you have the names of, I know there's a couple.
I know Aimee Wagner is one of them. She's worked with us in the past. Have you ever had business with her? Designs by Aimee, I think is
name. I know Aimee. I don't know if it's because when she's been to the office, I used to use Carista Hanna quite a bit, who does a lot of Homerama stuff, but she only does home renovations and new construction now. But I do have, besides Aimee Wagner, there is a company that Carista referred to me and that they did a nice job. So I'll have Eli, if he can't find that information, Aimee, I'll send it to you.
I'm trying to find it. I know we used it for Norton Commons, but I can't remember.
Yeah, I want to say it's Designs by Lynn or something like that. But there are, and then I know there are cheaper options out there because I think in our Keller Williams thread, we've seen some good suggestions in there as well.
Yeah, so one way to search that is to go to our Facebook resource page and go to the search bar and just type in stage or staging and you could find some info there. So I don't know Krista, who you mentioned, but I'll put Aimee's in here in the chat.
And really, you know, it in this market, you're not going to need it on homes really below 250. Just because as long as they declutter, it's going to take care of a lot of the issues. Now, if you've got every room a fluorescent paint color, you know, that's something different. what I tell my sellers is that they can typically do the work significantly cheaper than what a buyer is going to estimate. I had somebody who had horrible paint and then the texture was peeling off their ceiling. I mean, you walked into the house and it screamed foreclosure. Well, they spent a few $1,000s. I went back the other day and they easily doubled or tripled the value of their house based on what they paid in paint. So, you know, if sellers can do it themselves, it typically, Living Spaces by Lynn. I just found it. I'll stick this in. Oh yeah, Eli did it.
He's fast.
Yeah. So those are two good options, but I think you can also find some in the, and you can rent furniture. My Norton Commons seller, we rented a dining set because their dining set was really outdated and it made a really big difference. And that's something that, like I said, will become more important when we start to see a shift in the market. So going over comparables, everybody does it a little bit differently. I sat in on Seamus's CMA class last year, and I find it really interesting to see how people price because there's no specific, like, exact way to do it. I try to stay within the neighborhood. Sometimes you're not able to do that, so then you want to go with a radius. Appraisers like to stick within a mile. I do a lot of business in Oldham County where I've seen appraisers go up to 5 miles. If you're in a rural location, they will go further out. And then what you want to do is try to find the comparables that really are most specific to your house, because you've got to sell it to the seller or to the buyer, but then you've also got to sell it to the appraiser. And we are seeing right now some properties not appraised because the sales aren't matching the current market. You know, 6 months ago, we were right around the time COVID first hit, and we did have a couple of, you know, a few slow weeks in there. So you really got to make sure that the pricing matches the actives, the pendings, and the solds. And then talk with your seller about what happens if it doesn't appraise. I know Brad talked about that at the sales meeting last week. Eli puts together a great packet for all of our listings that includes the comparables that we used. If our houses sell for above list, I will sometimes adjust those comparables and try to find ones that match the price a little bit better. We put together an update sheet that the sellers have provided to us. It's important to include the year that they made those updates because the appraiser does give more value if a kitchen was renovated 2 years ago than a kitchen being renovated 10 years ago. We include any information. If it was a multiple listing, multiple offer, we write down the number of offers we got, the values that were in there, because, you know, all of that can help. We've run into recently two appraisal issues, but they were both on condos, and our condos went for well above the comps. And, you know, condos are tough because, you know, you're sometimes competing with your exact floor plan. But just make sure the sellers know their options if, when you get to that appraisal, if things do come in a little bit low. I was telling Aimee about a story. I listed a house. The day we listed is the day the governor put the COVID restrictions on Louisville. So the timing was horrendous. It was a really unique house. The only house I had ever seen sell like this in Oldham County. And so I couldn't find a comparable anywhere close to it. So the seller wanted to list it a little bit higher than what I thought would be a good option. So I had him complete a reduction form as part of the listing. It was, I believe, 3 weeks into the listing he was supposed to drop it. We got to that point. We'd had a whole bunch of showings and no offers, and he became really upset that I was going to force him to drop the price. So what I did is I gave him a day or two to think about it, and he ended up agreeing to a slightly less price reduction. But the interesting part was a week later, he dropped it to even lower than what we originally recommended, and it went under contract in like 2 days. So sometimes you have to give the sellers a little bit of time when they have a really strong emotional reaction. And he ended up giving me amazing reviews after the closing. It was one of those where I just had no idea how we felt about it. I never met him in person. We'd only talked on the phone. He was out of state. But he became a big advocate of mine. So just handle things gently, because people are going through a massive amount of stress. And I have learned over the years that we have got to be the calm voice in the transaction. I mean, sometimes you have the agents on the other end losing their minds, and you know, the buyers and sellers are losing their minds, and nothing good comes of people getting upset and screaming. So if somebody's got to keep the level head, just make sure it's you, because there's almost nothing you can't work through. But if people start to scream and yell and accuse, then it's just going to go down the tubes in a heartbeat. So I didn't used to be that way. It took me a few years to figure that out, but it has definitely made work and life a lot easier, even when other people are not exactly following the same suit. You just got to be, you know, the level head.
So Maggie, let's go back to the pricing. Because I feel like that's usually one of the biggest objections that you're going to get. So first off, let's just play. So Maggie, you know, I'm looking at these comps, but I feel like this market's pretty hot from what I hear. Can't we just list it 5,000 or 10,000 more and see what happens?
Yeah. And I completely agree. We are in an amazing market right now. And the one thing I'm seeing is, because buyers know that sellers are very often getting even above list price, that they don't want to come in and insult you with an offer if they feel like your home is not worth as much as what we've listed it for. They will oftentimes move on to another house rather than go through the emotional process of writing an offer and then possibly not even getting a response from the seller. You know, a buyer's not going to make an offer just because they like the house. They know that they're buying at the peak of the market, and they don't want to be that last buyer to buy at the peak before the market shifts. So that's why I recommend we list it and have at least 2 full days of showings, because then the buyers are going to be the ones that tell us what the house is really worth. You know, there's really no such thing as undervaluing a house in this market, because if the buyers see the value, they will often pay even above market price. What do you think of that?
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. And I think that that's a good point that you're making, is that many sellers might think, well, we'll just let them offer us and we'll just counter them. They don't realize that they might be scaring those buyers away completely, where they don't even give them a chance.
Yeah. And I think it's, you know, a lot of us, you know, nowadays work with buyers and sellers. I know with some teams it used to be where one just specialized in another. But I like to tell my sellers that I do about 50% buyer and 50% sellers. So I see both ends of the coin, and I see what buyers go through when they fall in love with the house but feel like they're going to insult the seller, not get their offer accepted, have an appraisal issue. They would rather move on than be that buyer who either overpays or you know, goes through that pain of not getting the house that they wanted.
Mm-hmm. All right, so I've got the other pricing or money objection here. So Maggie, I've got 4 other agents that are coming over and doing their presentation with me, and one just left and said that they'd be willing to list at 5% commission.
Yeah, and I completely appreciate the importance of, you know, talking to multiple agents. We all work very differently, and you really need to find somebody that you have a good fit with. Just like with myself, you know, I like to make sure that I work with people that I know that I'm going to be able to make happy. You know, and it's really interesting how we get paid, and I don't think a lot of people understand. At closing, my commission check goes to my broker. And then they pay me from that. 1% of my commission goes to taxes. 1% of it goes to my broker. And then on that other 1% is where I pay for all of your advertising and marketing fees, and then need money to bring home to put food on the table. Those agents that are doing it for 5%, they're going to end up taking it out of the marketing and the advertising, and then they're not going to be putting in the effort that is needed really to get your house sold. That is what I use on a regular basis, because people truly don't understand how we get paid. I mean, they see that massive commission check, or they watch $1 million agent and think that we're walking away with six-figure commissions. But I know too, you know, Aimee, you really like the, and there is a bold script about, you know, talking about that if people can't, you know, negotiate their own commission, how are they going to negotiate for your house? You know, if they're able to give up that easily and not, you know, negotiate and to be able to prove their value, then, you know, they're going to be the ones that want you to drop the price and just accept any offer that comes in. So yeah, you just need to go with whatever script makes most sense for you and that sounds most natural coming out of your mouth. But I can tell you, you know, breaking it down to how we get paid, you know, is something that I've had a lot of success with, and that some people you just can't make happy. I mean, there's companies out there that will list for $300, and if somebody is satisfied with the service they're going to get there, they're not going to see the value that you're providing. So just know that, you know, not everybody is meant to be your client. And I still have to remind myself of that. But, you know, sometimes it is a blessing when you don't end up with certain people. And also know that even once you're in, I mean, last year I canceled two listings, never had done that before. But both of them were really unique properties where we did our best on pricing, but after dozens of showings, it was obvious from feedback that buyers weren't agreeing with the price and the sellers wouldn't drop it. And they were both, and Eli can attest to that, they were both taking up massive amounts of time and energy. So in those cases, it just made sense. And we parted ways in a pretty good way. I mean, it was one of those where I just talked about the fact that, you know, if we're not on the same page, you know, we're just not meant to work with each other at this point. One of them never relisted. Another one relisted about 4 months later. And last I checked, we're at the price I wanted them to drop it to when we canceled. So, you know, you can't win them all. And there is nothing more freeing than getting rid of a client that was just eating you up.
Mm-hmm. And sometimes they just have to see for themselves. It's like raising children. You know, you can give the lectures all day long, but sometimes they just have to live and learn.
Exactly. And I know we've gone over a lot. Do you guys have any more? Another thing I do after I leave is I send a handwritten note. You know, I like to do that. It's just kind of another way to reach out and touch the sellers. After the appointment, I remember one agent in our office used to send a Lowe's gift card after the listing appointments. I'm a little cheaper than that. but I know we've gone over a lot. Do you guys have any other questions?
Where are you getting your stats from, the list to sale price and all that stuff?
So is that something I have Eli pull for me from the MLS? So he's able to pull my previous listings to see, you know, and one thing I do with my days on market is it frustrates me if a house sells in 3 days, but then goes back on the market because of financing or something like that, it adds it to the days on market. Well, if you sold it for 3 days both times, that's one of the things I don't agree with days on market. But yeah, Eli pulls those stats and he's able to do that. I know Dave Halpern used to teach a class on it, but Eli may be a better one to answer that question since he does it for me.
Yeah, I think if you look up your own profile on the MLS and then look at your listings, how many, whatever listings you've sold in a particular period of time, I think if you do a quick CMA, on that, I think that's a quick way to see what the percentage They'll give you the percentages in that like one sheet CMA type thing. So try that. I think that's usually how I end up doing it.
Okay. And don't forget too that there's that video from the Ignite Session 5 with Seamus where he goes over how he does his CMAs as well. So he goes step by step through the MLS. Now I know with Seamus, he does the adjustment style. So there's two different ways that you can do it. Some people like the apples to apples, which is kind of like what Becky Lush does. She's great at CMAs. And what that means is if you've got a ranch home, you're not going to pull, you know, a colonial. You're going to go out a little further on the radius and look for more ranches so that that way you're comparing apples to apples. With Seamus's class, he shares with us the way he adjusts. So he's still kind of looking for the same layout, but he gives some tips on how to adjust with that. Jason McCartan from Bello Demora also has a great class that he taught, and it's on our resource page. And he does the adjustment approach as well and has an adjustment sheet that I'm happy to also email out to you all if you'd just like to see the range of how much they deduct and add for maybe an extra bathroom or finished basement or something like that.
Yeah, and I used to do it that way. I'm not sure, I don't think it was intentional when I went to pulling more apples to apples. And then what I do is I'll give the seller a range. One thing I have learned is if my seller needs to do a lot of work, you certainly don't want to pick a price at that point, because depending on how good of a job they do, it could be worth even more after they do, you know, the updates you've recommended, or if they don't do a good job, it's not worth as much. You don't want to pigeonhole yourself into a specific price until you've seen the final product. I have been blown away at what some of my sellers have done between the first listing appointment and it being ready for pictures. So I'll give a range and say, you know, we're going to do one more walkthrough right before, you know, we do pictures. I'll pull any last minute comps and then we'll pick, you know, that exact price, but let them have a little bit of an input into it. So it feels like, you know, they've been part of the process, but I do give them a range and let them know that, you know, it will, you know, this is what we can expect at the lower end. This is what you can expect at the higher end, but I typically don't give a very big range. But then let them kind of choose in between that. I have found, you know, they're just more on board with things if you have to do a price reduction, if they were the ones that kind of helped pick it out in the beginning. And the thing is too, you've got to watch with dollar amounts for things is it can be different values in different neighborhoods. You know, basement finishes in one neighborhood can be hugely different from basement finishes in another. So you've just got to look at how those vary from neighborhood to neighborhood. And, you know, it can be tough. I mean, some houses are incredibly hard to value, and just know that an appraiser is going to be struggling just as much when they go to value it as well. So, you know, sometimes you just have to test the market and see if the buyers respond and hope, you know, that and make those quick adjustments if you didn't get it right. I think that's all I've got on my lengthy list. Aimee, did you want to talk about anything else?
I guess the only other thing that is coming to mind is, you know, when they say, well, I've got a few more agents coming over and, you know, I'd like to hear what they have to say. I know Becky's really good at this too, and I've heard some bold scripts on this as far as, you know, if it might be uncomfortable, you might be uncomfortable giving those agents a call. I'd be happy to do that for you and let them know that you've chosen to hire me, you know, and even the words hire me are kind of those embedded commands that we learn in bold where you're nailing it down. And if they give any pushback, you know, if they're not hiring you right away, then you can just ask them, you know, is there anything that I've said or not said that, you know, to prove that I'm the one that you want to get your house sold, you know, so maybe just point blank ask them, is there something that maybe I didn't explain enough or present enough to you to show that I'm the right one for the home? You know,
yeah, I think that is phenomenal. And then two questions that I didn't go over that have had a big impact is ask if they've had previous experiences with agents. Some of them never have. Others have had horrible experiences, and find out what was bad about those experiences. Mm-hmm. Because sometimes it's not necessarily the agent's fault, but just know that you don't want to make that same mistake. I have gotten some really enlightening information asking that. And then asking what would create a 10 experience for them? Because everybody is looking for something different. Some want top price. Some want the quickest sale. Others, you know, need that constant handholding, but you really need to find out what, but I got a listing a few weeks ago. The sellers were so blown away when I asked them what was important to them. And they ended up not interviewing the other agents they were planning on it. And for whatever reason, that just like sealed it for them. So it is, you know, you want to make it out like you care. Another thing is the company I was at previously, when you, they had a referral team. So they would pick the agent that they would send any referrals through. And I had a seller who had a tiny little cheap house in the middle of nowhere. Well, the agent they sent, my clients felt like they didn't like the house. And so they called me up and they felt really bad, but they said we couldn't use her because she didn't seem to care about the house. So I always make sure if I want the listing to let them know what a beautiful house they have and just, you know, how much I would want, you know, to be the one to sell it for them, because some people need that. They need to know that you love it as much as they do. Others, it's all about the numbers, but that's something I learned over the years too. Yeah. And I'm not, you know, I could definitely be better at the scripts. I am not somebody that's a hard sell. So that's something, you know, that we can all constantly work on, just, you know, and not that we need to be hard sells, but, you know, just tightening up some of that scripts when we get people that are really pushing back.
And I would also add that, you know, the communication style matters as well. So what I used to ask my sellers, if I had, you know, the husband and wife there, I would just kind of jokingly say, which one of you is the worrier? You know, because there's always one that's the worrier. And they, you know, they would point, you know, or, you know, the person would point, I am. And then, so I would just say, you know, then you'll be the one that I reach out to. You know, and I think that's important to make sure that you're talking to the right person. And that way you don't have to repeat yourself by reaching out to both of them. The worrier will take care of that for you. And yeah, I just think that that shows that you really understand that this is an emotional process and that you, you know, you want to make sure that you are communicating the way that they want to be communicated with.
Yeah. I mean, I've had people cry at listing appointments. They were so sad about selling their house. But I had one the other day who was cheering because they paid their house. You know, everybody is in a completely different situation. So yeah, just trying to find out what really matters to them makes a huge difference.
Yeah. All right. Any other questions?
I think that's all I've got.
Well, Maggie, this was really helpful. Thank you so much for coming from Contribution and sharing your time and your wisdom with us. And to everyone, just know that I've sent those emails out to you so that you have the documents that Maggie shared, and you also have those CMA adjustment guidelines. If there's anything at all that I can help you with, please let me know. And if you wanted to see this recording, it will be on our YouTube channel so that you could go back, especially the parts where I went through things kind of quickly in the beginning. So I hope this is helpful. And thank you again, Maggie, for being here, and Eli for helping out. We appreciate you.
Yeah. Thanks for having me. And I hope it was helpful. I know I can ramble a little bit.
Oh, it's perfect. All right. Well, everyone have a wonderful day. It looks like the sun popped out again. So enjoy this weather if you can, and have a wonderful day. See you soon.